I want you guys to be able to hunt the entire rut. There's so much rutting opportunity that takes place just outside the peak rut. The peak rut, of course, is what everyone thinks of. That's everyone's rutcation. But really, there's a pre-rut opportunity. There's the post-rut. There's a second rut. And then there's also the rut lockdown that takes place in and around the peak rut. So you really need to know all these phases. It's important to know each phase because with those phases comes opportunity. It's really important. There's a lot of detailed information. We're going to run through this in 10 minutes, 12 minutes, but there's a lot more information than we're just sharing right here. And that's how we came up with our rut hunting web class. You can purchase that on our website, whitetailhabitatsolutions.com. I urge you to check that out. You know, Dylan, do you remember how many videos are in there? Is it 14 or 13 or is it more like 16?
16, I think, yeah.
Yeah, you can check out. It details the number we have there. And so you can imagine there's several hours of footage in those and video in there. So that's a little bit different than what we're going to cover here in 10, 12 minutes. But I want to break this down. A lot of people can afford to buy those classes. That's okay. We'll try to condense it and we'll try to produce a whole bunch of videos so you can watch it for free. Just not as detailed and not in order and not breaking it down as extensively as we'd like to show you in that rut web class. So bottom line is, starts with the pre-rut. Pre-rut is that time where the bucks are ready, the does aren't. There's not a lot of does coming in to eat. There's not even really a lot of chasing. It's bucks are just ready. Back in their bedding areas, they might only move another 50 yards, 100 yards, but they're out there making rubs and scrapes during daylight. They're hitting water holes during the daylight. They're thirsty because they're working up a thirst. So then you all of a sudden, water holes, we don't get a lot of pictures of in the morning. And all of a sudden at 10 o'clock, 11, 1, we're getting bucks visiting water because they're working hard and they work up a thirst, just like you or I would if we're playing ball or sports or whatever you're doing. You get thirsty. Exerting yourself, you get thirsty. They do too. So they hit water holes all of a sudden in the morning. That's a really telltale sign that the rut is starting to begin. It's really, the rut's on. So very important to understand that pre-rut is not when bucks are being bred, but it has happened at the same time every year. You know, around here it's going to happen 20th, 24th, 26th. In all of these, the intensity of each one of these phases is going to be magnified during the daylight if there's good weather. If it's unseasonably warm in your area, it doesn't matter if it's Florida, Louisiana, or Wisconsin, Michigan, New York, North Dakota, the northern states, Vermont, New Hampshire, Maine. Doesn't matter where you're at or if you're down in the south, those extreme south areas, Texas, Louisiana, Georgia, Florida, Alabama. You're going to see the intensity pick up of any kind of hunt if the weather's decent. If it's really hot, really windy, really extreme weather, you're not going to see this. And deer will still be bred at night outside of the pre-rut. Once the doe is starting coming into heat, it's a trickle effect. All of a sudden you have a few right here. And then exponentially, there's a whole bunch. And then it goes back down. Where you see the activity is about here to here. You know, the peak is somewhere, you know, you'd say peak. This is when the most does are coming in traditionally. But every state figures that out differently. You know, some include the second rut. And there might be, depending on if it's a southern state, you could have a lot of deer coming in the second rut and the third rut. So then that could look at, make it look like there's this rut it traditionally in some certain time frame, but it's all over the charts from one county to the other because they look at it differently. That's why a lot of rut maps, they vary so greatly from one state line to the next, just different ways that they're tabulated. Not that it changes going over a state line, it does not, or from county to county. It only changes because of the way the state or feds or government agencies in your area record the rut and tabulate the rut. The bottom line is you start to see a lot of does coming into place, and that's when the lockdown takes place because the lockdown takes place when bucks are on does. After this point of the season, or the rut, who knows when a buck is coming off from doe and going to another one. It might take him 5 days to find another one. He only breeds 2 to 4 does. Think about that, 2 to 4 does in that primary rut. He is not breeding another doe every day. He's searching, looking, it takes several days to find another one. He has to fight off other doe or other bucks. So it takes a long time. And so that first one, every buck's invited to the party. That's that lockdown period. That's why there's a lockdown. You see the scrapes dry up. It doesn't mean it's not the rut. It doesn't mean it's not started. It means it's going on so much that bucks aren't moving. Because why does a buck want to push a doe to another buck? They sit tight, they breed, and then that's when the peak rut takes place, meaning peak rut activity, peak of activity. That's what we're referring to on a lot of these. Because the peak of activity takes place when there's a lot of bucks coming, or a lot of does coming in heat, and there's bucks really moving all over looking for that next one. They might find another one in 2 or 3 days. They might find another one in 7 or 8 days, but they're going to keep moving and looking. and searching. That's that whole peak rut period. When it's really intense out in the woods, that's when a lot of people try to hit with their vacations. Not the lockdown or the pre-rut, but the actual peak rut. Lockdown doesn't all of a sudden just take place during the middle of the peak rut. All the does just in unison coming to heat, and all the bucks are breeding within that 4 or 5 day window. It only happens for 4 or 5 days, the rut lockdown, but it's ready between the pre-rut. Then exponentially they start taking off, rut lockdown, and then you move into the peak rut. Then there's the post rut. That's where you get some bad weather days. And I would say the post rut around here, our peak rut would be anywhere from the 3rd, 4th of November through the 15th, or through the 10th, 12th, 13th of November. But then you get into the 14th, 15th, 16th, 17th, 18th. It's still considered, there's a lot of does coming into heat. Those bucks really aren't moving much during the day. They're getting wore out. Think of about the 15th around here. They've already been rutting for 3 weeks, really exerting themselves. They probably lost 25% of their body weight. They're really, really pushing hard and moving. And they're worked out. They're tired and they're ready to stop. So they don't move much during the day. That's that time period where a young buck just, I'm done with this. But those old bucks still know the game. They still have the energy. They still have the body size and the fat reserves to continue going. And they do, but not when it's bad weather. So you really have to watch, you know, we're watching this 12th, 13th through the 17th of November. That's that post rut as far as activity levels go that you're really looking at. And when the weather's good, you're going in there and you're hunting. Then the second rut. Think about that rut lockdown. All these does are coming in. Well, then fast forward about a month. And that's where you're going to have a lot more does weren't bred that first time, because let's face it, there's more does than bucks in almost anywhere. Unless you're in a fenced area and they keep it 1-to-1. But usually about, if you do the math, because of button bucks and fawn bucks being born, the worst ratio you can ever get is about 3.something to 1. A lot of people don't realize that. They think that, well, I'm only seeing 20 does to one buck. Well, that's because your land, your hunting stinks. Your food sources stink. You're probably overpressuring it. I mean, you have a lot. Usually when you see that happen, you have a lot of food, a lot of cover, but hunters hunt invasively. They push off the deer and the bucks are somewhere else. So you've seen those kind of numbers. Someone else is collecting bucks in your area, and unfortunately, when it comes to mature bucks, there's only about 5% of the properties that actually collect mature bucks, because hunting pressure is what rules, not the quality of food or cover. If you can add all three together, you get rid of the hunting pressure, the assumption to the deer anyways, or the presence of it to the deer, and then you add good food and good cover, then you're gonna have a lot of mature bucks there. But, you know, almost all hunters overpressure their food plots and they hunt invasively. So bucks get pushed to the side somewhere else. The ratios can never be worse than that 3-to-4 does for every one buck because of the bucks that are being born every year and added back into that crop. So think about that. Second rut takes place on time around here, end of November, early December. And in a way, it can be there's bad weather. You know, if there's bad weather during the peak rut, the primary rut, it's been really stormy, windy, rainy, and you have a lot of volatility for days at a time, then there might be some missed does because bucks weren't traveling very far to find them. They're just locked down because of the bad weather. So you can say, well, one second rut might be better than the other from year to year, but consistently it takes place at the same time. And it's the most missed time for hunting opportunity, let alone rut opportunity during the year. So let's look at real quick, pre-rut. I love getting in close to where a buck's at in his bedding area, mature buck that I'm after, and find that he's a little bit more active. And actually, that's the first time I go into some of those pre-rut morning stands. Those morning stands in general, because I want to find that activity and capitalize on it. It's a really good time to do that. But if you don't have a mature buck, you can go sit down in your favorite bedding area, and if he's bedding somewhere else, you're not going to see him. That's where you need the lockdown, especially the peak rut, because you needed him to find a doe or two, and then during the peak rut, he's going to come over to you. And that's what a lot of people rely on. But I want you to do something different. I want you to have good bedding areas, good food. Have mature bucks around, even one or two in that pre-rut that you can actually hunt, as opposed to having to wait for just the peak rut. Because the pre-rut takes about 8 to 10 days. The lockdown takes about 4 days, and then you have peak rut. So a lot of people are missing the entire 12 days of pre-rut and lockdown, 14 days. And then they're only relying on those, that 10-day window, 8-day window, 7-day window of peak rut opportunity as far as deer woods, during the woods activity and shootable activity. And then you have that post rut and second rut. Post rut, just a handful of days. Second rut is more like a week, 10 days. So I'm hunting AM bedding. Lockdown phase, you never know when a buck is going to come off his first doe. So all day, that means midday, morning, afternoon. Again, focusing on the weather. You know, we always mention HuntCast, HuntWise. Link is in the description so you can save 25% off. I love passing savings to you guys. But bottom line is, lockdown and peak rut, they could be all day, midday too. You don't see that in the pre-rut, so I'm not sitting out all day. I might sit morning somewhere, evening somewhere, and take several hours off in the middle of the day, like I'm doing right now. We're shooting videos. We're hunting tonight, hunting this morning. It's in the pre-rut, almost lockdown phase. And then the peak rut, all day. Post-rut, I'm really focusing on the AM bedding and the afternoon food source movement. But in the middle, you don't see a lot of movement. I'm not saying you don't see any at all, but they're starting to get tired out, and you see them really focusing towards evening food, morning bedding. And the same with the second rut. I see a lot of concentrated movement during the morning, heavy. And in the afternoon, you don't see as much during the midday. But hey, if you're out there and it's in a morning bedding area, that's where I'd hunt the midday anyways, is towards bedding. So I would actually, if I had the time, I'd sit till 2-3 in the afternoon and then go hit an afternoon evening food source related rut stand. So I'm not saying you shouldn't hunt in the middle of the day if you have that time, but if I did, I'd sit in my morning stand till 1, till noon, till 2, whatever it might be. So then you get safely over to your afternoon. You give yourself enough time to get into another stand. You're out in the woods all day. But that's how you're navigating that. So I hope that helps. This is navigating and how to hunt all of the rut phases, trying to help you understand why I refer to these phases and the timing of each. Then of course, I talk about these areas in my location right here, the pre-rut starting October 20th, 25th, the intensity and presence of the pre-rut, really magnified by the weather. And then in your area, you know, let's say Arkansas, you know, that area, that might be, that pre-rut might start November 10th. For you. Kansas, the pre-rut's more that first week, 10 days of November, and then your peak rut's more in the middle of November, charge 20th of November. You know, we go down to southern Ohio, I've shot a nice buck chasing does with my bow. That was a Monday before Thanksgiving. Went down there, they're about 10 days behind us. So you can go down there and count on some rut activity still taking place then, even if it's 20th, 21st, 22nd, you know, about 10 days after that same time period back here at home. So think about that for the timing your area, but bottom line is how you break it down. Again, 8-10 days for the pre-rut, 3-4 or 5 days for the pre-rut or the lockdown. That's when the bucks are breeding and then they finally get away. Peak rut, that takes place more like 7 days, 10 days, somewhere around there. Then you have the post-rut, handful of days. If the weather's bad, you might not even notice it. And then when the bucks stop rutting after the post-rut, they're done. They just lay around and do nothing. So then I focus on evening food sources, but that's not rut. And then the second rut, again, that might be 7-10 days. You're looking for that intense time. And it could be a week after that, a week before. You never know when that last one's coming in. But a lot of those young fawns will cue off their mothers, and that'll be about 30 days later. And that's a timing for missed deer too, missed does. So look at that 7-10 day window and really capitalize on that if you still have a tag in your pocket. And that's the phases of the rut. I hope you can take advantage of all phases of the rut this year. It's just not that 7 days, 10 days. There's a lot more to the rut and a lot more opportunity that a lot of people are missing out on. I don't want that to be you this hunting season. I urge everyone out there to really check out my web classes. They've been wildly successful. We have one that details how you should design your land, another one that details how you should plant and maintain and manage a food plot program. How can you make those decisions that fit your land specifically and not someone else's? Unfortunately, there's so much information in the hunting industry that says you should do this, but it doesn't apply to you. These web classes directly apply to you. And then we have our third web class that came out last year, Rut Web Class, Navigating the Entire Rut. And then we have our fourth one coming out, which is Hunting Hills and Thermals. I urge you to check those out, try the web classes, and they're all about teaching, helping you understand how you can navigate, not only managing your property, food plots, and the rut, but also hunting strategically, hills, thermals, and wherever you pursue whitetails for your dream and your passion.